Hi, I'm Peter Birch. Today we've travelled to South Florida to hang out with Kenan Harkin here at Kamp Kenan, looking at tortoises. Hope you guys enjoy it. Welcome to CrittaCam. Well, I guess.
Hey there, buddy.
This is pretty cool, man. I mean, it's like you got your own little Jurassic Park going on here, man.
You know, I think so many people that love reptiles would have, we all just want our own Jurassic Park. But, you know, the whole idea behind my place was to give these animals a lot of room to move. Because in my opinion, that's what makes them so exciting, is when you see them behaving naturally. And as I say that, we're sitting here feeding them. They're not behaving naturally in the way that they, you know that I'm their waiter. But, you know, just the greenery around, you know, these are two Galapagos tortoises. This is Darwin. This is Socrates. And Darwin came from San Francisco, which is, you know, about 3,700 miles away from me. It's a long way, man. And you know a little bit about traveling.
Oh, yeah.
Because I'm really psyched you guys made it all the way from Oz. But here's the deal. She was belonged to a gentleman who was a dentist, and he passed away. Oh. And you know, his wife was getting on in years. She's only 23 years old, and they needed a new home for it. So there's a global conservation society called the Turtle Survival Alliance, and I've been a member for many years now. Animal management guy Chris Hagen called me up, knew I had a big enough facility down south here in Florida, asked me if I would go to San Fran and get this tortoise. And, you know, if someone said to you, hey, man, you can bring a Galap into Australia, you just have to go to San Francisco and get it. What would you do?
You'd do anything,
you'd
right?
get there, yeah. So I actually wound up getting her, and the local wildlife sanctuary I work with, Bush Wildlife, were generous enough to use their connections because they do so many TV appearances and use the animals for TV. We got this animal in the cargo hold of a Delta flight from San Fran back to West Palm Beach. It was incredible. And she was like a celebrity, man. I was able to get in there and...
The rock star.
The rock star. Yeah, I've never flown. I've flown first class for real. This was way more first class because I actually got to get down on the tarmac, watch them load her. I went through security faster than anyone. So it was a really cool experience. But she's fantastic. She's benefiting from being here in a more naturalistic environment, you know, and she's doing really well. She's losing some weight, which is nice. You want your gals to be a little svelte.
Trim down a little bit.
You got it. Believe it or not, tortoises can get a little bit overweight.
I mean, this enclosure is absolutely amazing. It's so naturalistic. And I mean, you've spoken before about using a recycled concrete, but I mean, that is absolutely amazing. And it is perfect for these guys.
Right. You know, it's kind of what, you know, I'm all about is, you know, getting these animals outdoors, working, you know, being in a place where you can do that. Obviously, down here in Florida, and he's biting my leg right now. I think my khakis are some foliage right now. But, you know, being in Florida, I can work with a lot of animals. Being in the States, we can work with a lot of exotic animals. But the cool thing about, you know, big enclosures are, especially with tortoises, is the maintenance on the animals is it's greatly reduced, because these animals are going to walk around here and find little, you know, fruits. They're going to eat little vegetation that they subsist on, and then I come in twice a week and I supplement their diets. And she's definitely wanting some more food.
She wants
to be
more
supplemented.
Food. Yeah.
Supplement her
yeah,
more.
Yeah, I know.
We have to run over and get more cactus.
Have some more cactus. That cactus is pretty tasty, too.
You did taste it earlier.
Yeah.
I've never tasted it. I'm going to take your word for it. Sucks. What are you doing, buddy? Come on, man. He's eating my Dickies here. Dickies pants.
Let's hope so.
Yes.
Now, you've got another guy down here, haven't you?
Right.
Al Dabron.
Let's go see an Al Dabron.
Let's try
and
find him. This is a massive enclosure, so let's...
We'll try and find
see if we can find him.
Let's hustle, buddy.
Oh, man. I don't know about you.
Yeah?
This is pretty thick in here, you know?
It's pretty amazing, and actually, this is in the front of my home. And if you look, this is called palmetto. It's a native Florida tree, plant, if you will. It grows about a foot every 100 years.
Okay.
So think about how old this plant is. I mean, it's incredible, you know what I mean? It's a really, I've been around Florida. I haven't seen very many tall ones like this. And the other benefit for the Galaps is Galaps need exercise for their hind legs. So they have all these tree trunks to negotiate. That's great. You know?
I was going to ask you about them moving around because there is quite a lot of obstructions.
There are, but you know what? In the Galapagos, it's a volcanic island. It's very rocky. Those dudes just plow over it, man. They walk long distances. So it's neat, you know? I mean, they'll get in here and they do the weeding for me. And there's tortoise trails in here. You can see where they flattened out some of the leaves.
That's amazing.
Yeah, we still got to find Nostradamus. We got to find that out.
Let's find that guy. I guess finally we found her in the most unobvious place.
Well, no, actually, it's funny. It was raining a bit, so they're fairly intelligent here. They know what's dry. They have a spot that they'd like to be in. So this is Nostradamus. It's an Aldabra tortoise that I got in 2004 when I first moved down here to Florida. It was one of those bucket list animals, and we had the Daytona Reptile Show, the National Reptile Breeders Show. And this animal was imported into the United States from a captive breeding facility in the Seychelles. So this animal began in the Seychelles, which is part of their native range. And its shell's just gorgeous. You know, as a tortoise keeper, you strive to have, nice growth on the shell. I mean, when you look at this animal's shell, it's just beautiful. And again, I do things my own way. I never say this. It's the only way to do it. But with my experience in these animals, sometimes less is more. You know, people tend to want to overfeed tortoises in captivity, and I feel like you run into problems. You got to remember, tortoises are animals that subsist off of foods that are really not high in nutrients. You know, they're eating grasses.
Obviously, Australia has no tortoises.
Right.
We've been robbed, basically.
Yes, it's incredible, man. I can't believe it. I mean, Europe got tortoises. Australia would be a great place for tortoises.
You think we would have got some, right? But no, that never happened. So I guess for most Australians, they don't realize that these guys are basically like a cow or a sheep, they're a grazer.
Yeah, that's exactly right. They basically walk, nibble, walk some more, nibble, and all the while they're eating foods that are not that rich in nutrients.
That's right.
So what happens then is they have these extremely long digestive tracts, which keeps that roughage and food in it for a long time to extract absolutely everything they can get out of it, and they somehow grow. When I say less is more, with store-bought or prepared foods that you can buy in some of the pet stores, here in the States, they're really high in nutrients, and you can grow the animal too quickly. And that is a theory of mine. When you grow an animal too quick, you will start to see some pyramiding, but there are other factors to that as well. Humidity, diet, access to natural sunlight. There's a lot. But I do, just like Aesop's fable, slow and steady, man, finishes the race. These animals are going to live well over 100 years.
They're going to outlive us.
They truly are. And so this tortoise here, 11 years old, started out, tiny little hatchling. It's close to 100 pounds now. And here's another thing that most folks don't realize with giant tortoise species like your Galops or Aldabras. Yep. It's very difficult to positively ID their sex until they're about 200 pounds.
Wow.
They take a long time to get to that size. Like I said, 11 years. Darwin's 350 pounds, and she's 23 years old. Yeah. So you can kind of see. It's like once they get to 200 pounds, I'll be able to tell, are you a boy, Nazi, or a girl? Am I going to have to change your name? I don't know. But it's a fantastic animal. It's probably, I hate to say it, but it's probably my favorite animal here. I mean, I just love this animal. I mean, look at this. You know, the interaction.
That was the other thing, too, that you said earlier, is that most Aldabrans aren't known for their...
I've heard that. Exactly.
Nature,
the Aldabra
this guy
tortoise.
Is just absolutely amazing. The Glaps earlier were quite tolerant towards us.
Because you had food.
But right, we were food. But every time, you reach out to go near their face or even their neck like this, they'd pull back instantly. Whereas this guy is totally the opposite.
It's really cool.
As soon as he sees a hand, he sticks his head out.
I don't know if it's because there are birds that pick ticks off them in the wild and, they do that. Or in reality, I think it just feels good. I thought if you had dry skin, you'd probably want a good scratch.
Yeah.
So it's probably something as simple as that. I don't read too deep into it. I just like the fact that this particular Aldabra is friendly to me. I've had this animal since 2004. It knows me. It's friendly with my visitors. And, it's just a rewarding thing for me to be able to keep these animals that I've always wanted since I was a pipsqueak,
Yeah. I mean, he's a great ambassador animal, but you got so much more to show us.
Yeah, let's do it, man. Let's head over to Redford.
See you, guy.
All right. See you, buddy. Get that last piece, will you?
Kenan, for me, as a reptile guy, I mean, these big open spacious areas is something that we all like to see.
Yeah.
But you're doing it, you know?
I'm lucky, man. I mean, again, it comes down to the fact, you know, I live in an area where we, you know, I got 2.5 acres. These are the redfoots. And right now it's summertime, so I have the entire enclosure open. And they're a popular animal here in the United States. Very popular in pet stores. So, you know, but people take animals for granted. Like, I don't care how popular it is. It's still a tortoise. It's still something I've always wanted to work with. And you can just see that right now they're out having
they're
a
They're all coming out. Yeah, they're all coming out.
So they're all coming out. They know me. They know I'm the waiter. but they come out from all these little hides that the palmettos have. You can see they build like themselves little forms.
Yeah, so, I've seen them burrow down and there's a couple of little holes down there. And that's quite naturalistic. And the fact that they can do that and they're not trapped. And I mean, it's hard to say that being trapped in a box and you can, as an animal lover, you can almost read their eyes, you know. Sometimes you can see these animals and they look sad, but these guys are quite happy.
I think, you know, there's so many of us want to be, even scientists, want to be more like hands-off and, you know, we can't empathize with animals or anthropomorphize, that's even the right word. I stumble on that word all the time. Go and Google it. But anyhow, when we put our emotions on the animals, I actually think to a level that's good.
Yeah.
With certain animals, there is a bit of an intelligence with tortoises. You know, 250 million years on Earth, you're not stupid. You're doing something right.
No.
So when you can give these animals a spacious environment, there's 24 of them in here. You know, so I dislike intensely crowding animals.
Yeah.
You know,
these guys aren't crowded.
More isn't always better, but space is good to a degree. Now, you know, here's the thing, Pete. You know, it's one of these things where I spend my day doing laps around my house. You know, I love it. I'm very lucky. But I know these animals. I know when they're behaving right. Like if I see one of them hasn't come out for food, I know something's up.
Yeah, you'll go looking for them?
Right. I'll go looking for them. I'll just make sure everyone's out doing their thing. I'm a little bit like, you know, a savant in that way. I walk around. I'm like Rain Man, like the movie Rain Man, just trying to figure everyone out. But have a look at this, If you notice, there's an enclosure within an enclosure.
Yes,
summer,
I did notice
right
that.
Now,
yep.
Winter comes, they get a smaller enclosure. It also coincides with their egg laying season.
Okay.
So it's easier for me to find the eggs. It's still a large enclosure. Their bunker, the tortoise bunker, is in there. It's insulated, heated, the whole nine yards. We'll take a look over there. But I kind of keep them in a smaller area because you have to work with, you know, you have to understand the situation you're in. And obviously these are tropical species. Florida is just perfect, almost perfect. It's subtropical.
Yeah.
So we do get some nights that drop down close to freezing, which obviously for this species is just not gonna cut it. But I just shut this off. They live in here. They love to lay their eggs up on the high ground here next to the bunker.
And it's really sandy soil too.
That's
the other thing too.
Yeah, they do their thing. And I let the bamboo leaves fall down. They love the leaf litter. They can hide their nest. They feel secure. But it's really great. And again, to hammer this home, in this type of enclosure, where they can get a bite to eat, when they can eat a little nibble here, I do feedings about 3 times a week.
That's the thing too, is a lot of the plants here are strictly there for the animals to feed on.
That's it, man. Yeah. I mean, I've become an amateur gardener just so that my tortoises can eat naturally. And most of those plants I'll plant on the opposite side of the wall, so when I'm trimming the verge, I just trim it, toss it in, and they come right over to it, man.
I mean, look at these guys.
Yeah, yeah. So some of these were rescues. Some of these, you know, might be a little more pyramided than others, but if you're a tortoise, I love you. You're coming over to Kamp Kenan.
Yeah, well, what a place to go.
Hey, thanks. I'm glad you guys are here.
Let's you got plenty more to check out.
Yes, definitely.
So you got so much more around here.
Yeah, man, it's you know, I don't like to mow lawns, so I just add tortoise enclosures.
Well, these are your lawnmowers right here.
These are my lawnmowers. They're like the Flintstones lawnmowers, and these are you'll see 2 different species in this enclosure, but the fun thing about this is most of the time you keep your species separated, you know, by geographic location or by species, right? With tortoises, you don't want any cross-contamination of disease. And there's also habitat requirements that come into play. Now, these in the wild are found in overlapping territories.
Okay.
So you're looking at the Burmese Black Mountain Tortoise.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They're obviously Burma, Myanmar now it's called.
Yep.
And what's cool about these guys is, as far as a tortoise for Florida, them and the animals they're cohabitating with are called elongated tortoise, also from Southeast Asia, and found in forested areas with dense canopy. These guys can take cool temps. yep. which is neat. I don't do anything special for these tortoises unless, I mean, and this is so infrequent here in South Florida that we get what we call a cold snap and it gets below freezing. Otherwise, nights in the 50s, upper 40s, as long as there's a lot of leaf litter,
yep.
a little shelter they can get into, I don't have to do any supplemental heating at all.
Well, I did notice it is a lot cooler here because of this big mango tree. Right. And the big mango tree, it's a bit of a warning sign too, isn't it?
Oh,
we've got to be a little bit cautious. Earlier on, we had a ripe mango fall, and it was almost like running for cover, right?
No doubt.
But it serves a purpose, correct?
It is an automatic feeding station, man. And the neat thing is, and I've heard this from biologists that study these animals out in Southeast Asia, these tortoises, you know, you got to remember, tortoises don't have huge ranges. What they do is they have a home range, and that's part of why tortoises all over the world and turtles are under threat of extinction. It's from habitat fragmentation.
Yeah.
Roads dissecting their areas, new shopping malls going up, and so forth. But to get back to it, these tortoises, man, will know their layout. They know where there's water. They know when it's gonna, you know, fruit's gonna fall, that they will collect near the base of fruit-bearing trees and wait. And if you're a tortoise, you're patient to begin with, but
oh, yeah.
you wait for your food. It's not like you're an agile hunter, you know? So they're gathering, but they know when things start to fall. And I mean, it doesn't last long here.
No, I noticed the mango did hit the floor and
it's gone.
I don't think I can find it anymore.
No, it's gone.
Like you were talking before, these beautiful yellow turtles, I mean,
you've got this elongated
wonderful yellow shell, mm-hmm. as well as the really attractive yellow face too.
Right, yeah, the elongated tortoise, and what I'll do is let's have a look at one.
They're pretty snake.
So this is a cool animal.
I should say turtle.
Yeah, no worries. There you go, snakes on the brain.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, the elongated tortoise, obviously it's got an elongated shell. It's got that pretty yellow head that will turn pink in the breeding season, which we're about to head into.
You can see a little bit of pink starting on the tip of the nose.
Eh? Yeah, it's really neat. Now, these animals here are extremely endangered. Both the black mountain tortoise and the elongated tortoise are really endangered in their native ranges because they're being eaten into extinction. Mm. It's sad, you know. I mean, tortoises are not really designed for the modern world and for our crafty human brains.
Yeah.
They pretty much pull in and hope for the best.
Yeah.
It doesn't necessarily work when you
not
have
much of a
bandsaw
really.
That can just cut right through these little guys.
Yeah.
So, anyhow.
I guess, ever since you put one of your first videos up about this guy here, I've always wanted to come and meet him, and now I'm here, and I've got the chance. And I mean, all the iguanas I get to see, you know, they're all captive animals, and they always seem to be pretty good-tempered animals.
Yeah. Pretty intelligent, too.
Tell me more about this dude right here.
Cuban rock iguana, man. You know, I had always, actually, you had visited Joe Wazalewski on this trip, and years ago he had, I forgot the name of his iguana, but he had a large Cuban rock iguana that I saw at one of the expos, and it was just so well behaved. It was just hanging out on the table. I decided right then and there I had to raise one up, but not only one, you can't just raise one.
No.
So I got Lola, his girlfriend, who's just about right there. You'll see her in a minute. So Guapo, this is Senior Guapo, is a Cuban rock iguana. I got him also in 2004. Both of them were about that big.
Tiny.
And they have always lived in here. So they've grown up in here. It's a large enough enclosure. It's about 24 by 12 foot, and this is where they live. This is their house. The rock iguanas are just that. I always say that they're the weightlifter of the animal world.
Oh, yeah.
They're just, you know, they're lizard world. They're so buff. They're more terrestrial. They don't really climb trees and so on. They'll clamber over rocks. I try and make things easy for them because they're not the nimblest.
Yes.
They're not like a green iguana.
No.
They're built for a different type of life. But, you know, herbivore, incredibly intelligent. And in my opinion, out of all the rock iguanas, now, and I can only really talk about two species. I only have really worked with the rhinoceros iguana and the Cuban rock. And they're both the most popular pet iguanas that is not a green iguana in the United States.
Yep.
What I would say is I just love the temperament of my Cubans. They tame very quickly. That being said, when we say tame, I don't want to give the impression it's still an animal, has a mouth.
Yep.
It may be upset one day. However, in the 11 years that we've been buddies, I've never, ever had one instance where this animal has lashed out at me. It always behaves like that. But you have to read its body language. So see how the animal is right now?
Yeah, yep.
All right, his head's up, his legs, he's standing up, but his tail, he's got it down.
Yeah, okay? He's quite relaxed.
Right now, there. When this animal gets a little agitated with others of its own kind or with someone who's mishandling it, it'll stand up, but its tail will be raised completely off the ground.
So the tail whip.
It'll give you a good whip. Yeah, okay. Definitely. But they can also do caudal autonomation. They can drop their tails if handled roughly or as babies. But fortunately, the only thing that's happened to Guapo is on this back leg here, good old Lola gave him a nip and bit off a little bit of his finger. Those Latin girls, man, you got to be careful of the Latin ladies,
rough,
dude.
Eh?
Yeah, they're a little rough. I got a Latin gal inside. She'll bite my finger off, too.
Oy.
Just kidding. But no, she's tough. Don't ever show her this video, please, God.
So I guess the same thing applies with all animals. It's that mutual respect.
It's a respect thing. Yeah. And it's
respect
again,
their space, respect what they want to do, as well as
they'll
let you come in a little bit closer and get a little bit friendlier.
You got to remember, if you want a dog or a cat, get a dog or a cat.
Yeah.
I mean, these are reptiles. We love them for different reasons. And there's so many of us that want to dress them up and put them in sweaters and so on.
Yeah, that's probably not the right thing.
That's not the right thing. I mean, these animals want to live outdoors in big enclosures. So my big thing, again, I've been saying it over and over again, find animals. And in Oz, you guys are lucky. You're lucky in the way of being limited to what you can keep, but you can keep animals that are in your country that you can kind of, that thrive in your country.
Yes.
So work with what you have and get them outdoors. They love it. Then they'll do better for you.
I tell you what, this guy's awesome.
Yep.
There's one more thing
that I need
to see, and
let's
I need to go out in the big paddock you got out there. It's huge.
All right, dude. And I'm so glad you're here. Let's go take a look at the sulcatus, man.
That's it for me, man.
This is the paddock, eh?
Yeah. This is a big deal for me. I remember, you know, when I wanted to move down to Florida, I always wanted big tortoises, and obviously the sulcata is the most accessible large species of tortoise in the United States. It is, you know, it's one of those animals that you can see at every reptile show, but I always stress to people when they get an animal from me that you make sure about the commitment.
Yeah, and, it's all their commitment.
It's about space with these guys. Now, there are 11 in this paddock, okay?
How big is it?
I think it might be close to a half acre, I think.
It's quite a decent chunk of your land.
It's
actually dedicated
good.
Just to 11 guys.
Just to these guys, you know. And again, it makes my life very simple. So 11 tortoises, there's three males, the rest are the gals. And I don't mow in here. The reason I keep it at 11 is I always get plenty of babies every year. The animals always have a nice weight. They eat all this grass, they keep it mowed, and you know, like I said, I'll supplement maybe once or twice a week with these guys to feed them more food. That's how I know they aren't eating the grass to the ground.
Yep.
You know, they aren't eating it away.
There isn't any bald patches.
No, not at all. Just under this hat.
So obviously there's a good number ratio out here for these animals. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And so right now the gals are out, and then there's one of the larger males is out there
right
too.
Right over the back there. Yep.
But you know, this has always been a dream, you know, to like I'm sure so many herpers in Australia. You know, it's a dream to share space with these animals. And for me, tortoises, you know, and the lizards I have. I love snakes, but sharing my yard with these animals has been kind of rewarding, to say the least. You know, these guys are really doing awesome. So, again, man, you got to get folks out there to do the right thing by the animal.
I tell you what, being here and seeing your land, and I mean, you've basically dedicated your whole block of land, and I mean, right up to the house. And there's a portion of your house you've also donated.
Yep.
Back to the animals. It's absolutely amazing. Where can people find out more about the work that you're doing with these beautiful creatures?
Hey, listen, if you folks are interested in, you know, seeing what I'm doing with the animals, you can check out campkenan.com, camp with a K. You can also check out my Camp Kenan YouTube channel. I love CrittaCam, guys. I'm so glad you guys came out here. But yeah, you can do that. You know, and we're just having a great time with our little show. A lot of the things I do are try and educate people how to take care of some of these animals. And really, it's for the benefit of all of us. Because at the end of the day, conservation has to be about sometimes keeping these animals in captivity.
Yeah.
Because we're losing habitat so fast. Tortoises don't reproduce quickly.
No.
So sometimes captivity is going to be the only viable option. So instead of whining that these animals shouldn't be in captivity, I'd rather see them in captivity in good circumstances than be extinct forever.
Most definitely.
That's it, mate.
Awesome. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this week's show. Please leave a comment below. Hit us up on Facebook and Twitter. And don't forget Instagram. Until next time, I'll be hanging out here with Kenan, checking out some more tortoises.
Got some Thai food to go get. It's going to be good. See you guys.